The last class we have discussed on the physical and chemical characteristics of wastewater, and in today's class we will be discussing on some of the biological characteristics of wastewater. Actually, this biological characteristics or physical chemical characteristics of water or wastewater, this we have just discussed in the previous semester itself. But we will be having once again a revision of all these the biological characteristics. Whatever you have studied in the previous semester regarding the biological characteristics, again we will be studying the same thing, but with having some of the bit additions are there in these biological characteristics of wastewater. Now, when it comes to the biological characteristics of the wastewater, we will be speaking basically on the living things which are present in the wastewater. Okay, so there are three kinds of things will be present in the wastewater that are present in wastewater. That is, the first one is aquatic plants, then aquatic animals, then the aquatic molds, bacteria, and viruses. Okay. Now, when we comes to the microorganisms, that requires a living tissue, we call them as a pathogen, and it is a parasite it is dependent on the host organism as a proper environment for the growth and reproduction. Okay. Now, normally the pathogenic kind of bacteria or the microorganisms, these are harmful to man. We are going to have the microorganisms can be either plants or these are as present as an animal. Okay, when the aquatic organisms drift, drift more or less passively with the waves and current, they constitute the plankton. Okay, now we will see, we will discuss regarding the aquatic plants which are present in the aquatic plants which are present. Okay, now we divide them into the four categories, that is spermophyta, bryophyta, pteridophyta, and thallophyta. Okay, the spermophyta we call them as water weeds, then the bryophyta we call them as it is having mosses and liverworts, then the pteridophyta it is going to have the ferns and ferns and hostels, and then thallophyta it is going to have the algae. Okay, the water weeds and the algae, okay, are of practical importance to the wastewater engineers or the sanitary engineers if the favorable conditions of light and temperature and nutrition are there, then the water weed will be growing in the dense form, and as I have told in the previous class while discussing regarding the nitrogen content, if the more amount of nitrogen, if more the nutrients are or the light are available, then these algae growth will be there. The greenish layer what you will see on the wastewater, if probably these algae and all, if a stagnant water is there, you are normally going to see these algae. Okay, algae is considered to be a most simple and photosynthetic plants, which is having the unicellular organs of reproduction, and they are going to be self-nourish their self, and they derive the energy from the simple inorganic the substances which comes from the sunlight. One of the most important problems to the wastewater engineers or sanitation engineer is regarding how to treat the waste of various origins which are going to be, when it is going to be discharged into the receiving water, then it do not encourage the growth of algae and other aquatic plants. Okay, then this is how it is going to create a problem for the aquatic sanitary engineers. When we discharge too much amount of waste, then it is going to create the problem to the receiving water body. Okay, then we will come to the regarding the aquatic animals. We divide the aquatic animals into vertebrate, then mollusca, arthropoda, worms, metazoa, and protozoa. Okay, the vertebrates are nothing but the fish. Okay, then mollusca is having, which is going to have them your mussels and snails, etc. Arthropoda will be having insects, the spider, then worms, rotifera, earthworms, metazoa, it will be having the hydra or polyzoa, then
protozoa will be having the Entamoeba histolytica, right? This protozoa is going to be very, very important for the wastewater engineers, or as a environmental engineering, it is going to be very, very important. Why? The protozoa is, it is going to, we call it, includes the amoebas, okay, then the flagellates and free swimming stocked the animals. Then the protozoa, these are having the unicellular, okay, these are having a single cell with having the binary fusion, right? They are lowest and simplest form of animal the life. These protozoa of the Entamoeba histolytica causes amoebic dysentery, as you know. In the previous semester also we have discussed that if the Entamoeba histolytica is responsible for the dysentery, if these microbes are there in the water, right, then it is going to cause the dysentery. Protozoa, if Entamoeba histolytica is there, then it is going to cause the dysentery for the human being. This is one of the waterborne diseases. Suppose in your water line, if by chance if any wastewater is going to be get intruded into your drinking water, and if the person is going to have the dysentery, then the Entamoeba histolytica will be responsible for that. Okay, so this Entamoeba histolytica, whenever that is the reason why whenever we need to, whenever we are going to drink the water, we should boil it and then we should drink it. Why? Because the at a higher temperature, the these kind of microorganisms, the Entamoeba histolytica, or the very minute kind of animal, or the microorganisms will be getting killed when we are going to give them a higher temperature. Okay, then we will discuss regarding the aquatic molds and bacteria and some of the viruses. Okay, now the fungi, as I have discussed, these are having the unicellular organisms. So they generally they survive in the pH in between aquatic molds, bacteria and viruses. It is having the fungi, virus and bacteria, we divide them into. And fungi will be studying, will be present in between the in between the pH range of around 4 to 10, and the reproductive stage is fungi is through a spore. Okay, then viruses, right? These viruses and bacteria, they are very dangerous for the human being, because they give different kind of diseases to the human being. And bacteria, some of the bacteria are helpful also, right? But viruses, they are smaller than the bacteria. Okay, now the bacteria, with regard to the viruses, right, with regard to viruses, these are having the ultra microscopic organisms. Okay, they are going to live in the host cell. Okay, they are having the size in between around 10 to 500 millimicrons. Okay, and then due to their very small size, we cannot see them through the naked the eyes. Okay, and then the different kinds of diseases that we are going to have due to the viruses are your adenovirus, then antenovirus, we are going to have the coccyca virus, then hepatitis virus, polio virus, reovirus. All these viruses will be going to give the different kinds of the diseases to the human being. Okay, so viruses, we need to remember that they are the smaller than the bacteria. Okay, then we'll coming to the bacteria. The bacteria are having the different categories are there in this. Some of the aerobic bacteria, and some of them are anaerobic bacteria, and some of them are the facultative bacteria. Aerobic bacteria are those which are going to live under the with the help of the oxygen, or which lives in presence of oxygen. And the anaerobic bacteria are those which lives in the absence of oxygen. And the facultative, either they live with oxygen also and without oxygen also, we call them as the facultative bacteria. And with respect to the temperature, the bacteria will be divided into mesophilic, thermophilic and metaphilic. Okay, psychrophilic, mesophilic and thermophilic. Psychrophilic bacteria are those which is going to be active in between 10 to 20 degrees Celsius, and the thermophilic bacteria are those which are going to be active in between 20 to 40 degrees 40 to 65 degrees Celsius, and
The mesophilic bacteria are those which are going to live in between 10 to 20 degree. So psychrophilic, lower temperature, mesophilic, moderate temperature, thermophilic, higher temperature. So when we want to drink water or drinking water, then if we want it to be free from microorganisms, then we should boil the water at a temperature more than 65 to 70 degrees Celsius, because at that particular temperature all the microbes which are present in the water, it is going to get die. Okay, now coming to the wastewater, then our human fecus, specially from the drainage and your septic tanks, we are going to give the wastewater, which is going to have the mixture of human fecus plus water. Normally, the human is going to liberate around, the human fecus is consisting around 10 raised to 11 to 10 raised to 13, these your coliform bacteria. We call them as a coliform bacteria. The bacteria which are going to live under the human fecus, we call them as the coliform bacteria. And these coliform bacteria are present in a huge number. They are going to be aerobic or facultative bacteria. Okay, and they are going to reproduce at a temperature of around 35 degrees Celsius for the period of 48 hours. Okay, now these are going to be very, very, these normally it will be there in human fecus, the wastewater containing the human fecus. In order to determine the different kinds of microbes which are present in wastewater, the presence of microbes, how we can determine is, we are going to have the three types of a test. One is your coliform index test, then we are going to have the most probable number, that is MPN test, in order to determine the different kind of, in order to determine what is the concentration or the how much is the concentration of the waste of the microbes which is present in the wastewater. In order to determine the concentration of the microbes which are present in the wastewater, we are going to find two tests. One is the most probable number, we call it as an MPN, and the next one is the coliform index test, we are going to have it. Okay, so this is regarding a brief introduction regarding the physical, chemical and biological characteristics of wastewater. So we have completed the physical and chemical and biological characteristics. We will just now complete, we will see regarding what is an aerobic process and what is an the anaerobic process. Okay, the work of the aerobic bacteria, that is the combination with the oxygen, is called as an the oxidation. If the microbes are surviving by consuming the oxygen, that is we call it as an aerobic process. And if the work done by the anaerobic bacteria, right, in the absence of oxygen, we call it as an anaerobic process. Okay, in the end products from the aerobic activity that we are going to get is the CO2, H2O and SO4, NO3, ammonia. That and then this is regarding your aerobic process. And the anaerobic process, the bacteria are going to oxidize, right? They are going to give you CO2, H2O, H2S, CH4, ammonia, right? And here in the anaerobic process, you are going to get the more smell, whereas in your aerobic process, you are going to get the less smell. So this is regarding the physical, chemical and biological characteristics of the wastewater. In the next class, we will be discussing on the wastewater treatment flow diagram, and what it will, how each and every unit of your wastewater treatment plant, how it is going to be working, that we are going to see in the next class, and that will be very, very important aspect as far your examinations are concerned. That will be normally asked to question in your main exam. Okay, so we will discuss regarding your wastewater treatment flow diagram in the next class. Thank you.